was
there.
And then his dad
went
there. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear.
Happy birthday to you. We can't see the candles.
Happy birthday, dear Crystal.
Where are the candles?
Happy birthday.
Yeah.
Ready?
No, it's fine. We don't.
The candles aren't lit.
One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Gibby. Happy birthday to
blow him! Blow him out!
Hurry up, or we're gonna have to start.
Hurry!
All over.
Yeah! Yay!
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear pastor. Happy
I don't think any of us had a clue or even the slightest inclination of what we would be going through in 2021 as individuals and also as a congregation. But I'm sure glad that we prayed and fasted in early January, for those of you that remember that time with us, because even though we didn't know what was ahead in 2021, God knew exactly what we would be going through individually, and God knew exactly what we would be going through as a church in 2021.
Believe we've come this far, and it feels just like getting started. Somehow we're still running like those kids back then. Scrape some knees and falling down, but somehow we keep getting back up. Long as there is wonder, gonna keep running, yeah, we'll keep running in this moment. It's electric, can you see it? Can you feel it? This dream inside is still alive today. Yeah, we're on our way.
So what is one of the lows that you guys remember that we faced as a church together, or maybe personally, that we went through this year?
Obviously, my mom's passing was hard for me, my brother, and the church in general. It was like, because we started off this year really good, revival after revival. We were just sweeping through the year with a spiritual high, almost as a church that we've never really experienced before. And then that kind of brought us all down. And it's been hard to recover from that as a church. I mean, and honestly, I don't think our church has experienced that before yet.
Right.
Especially ministry-wise. I mean, a ministry left that someone's had to take over. I mean, it was just, it's a mess still that we're trying to get over, but.
Yeah, that definitely was hard, I think, for everyone. And I think that we have faced, like, in the past, we have had people that have passed away, but your mom's passing was really, like, one that had more of an impact on the church.
Yeah.
Because of, like, how you said she was more involved, not just in the church, but personally, like, with everyone. Yeah, for sure.
And then, not only that, I mean, you're able to see how time is finite. I believe that is one of our lowest points as a church, is for us to have a member and then them pass away. Not only that, but me as an individual be prompted by God, I believe, to, you know, spend time, and for me not to take the time to spend more time.
For sure.
That's
right.
Even the worstest regret that you could ever have.
Right.
And still it's like lingering. And so it was almost like it was an eye opener. Like, you know, when you have the time, take the time to spend time with people. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, that's just.
It is crazy. I mean, that we don't. And it's almost like you can't know what that's like until you experience a loss like that. And it, like I said, it's not just a loss to me. It helps other people get into perspective, like their loved ones could be next.
Right.
You know, in that time. And then it puts into perspective the priorities of life. Like, it really shows you, like, we ain't here forever.
Yeah.
And what are we doing to gain everything we can here and not for the actual kingdom of God or for each other, even in the church? I mean, we still got to live on earth and pay bills and just get through life. But at the same time, it's like there's a whole other battle we're trying to fight. And, you know, it's made my brother and I closer. And I'm sure it's made other families closer in a sense that they want that time with each other. So, but, like, we just have to keep moving. But it is hard. Like, it's crazy. It was really a supernatural thing that kicked in for me during that moment, the first 3 months. But now that spiritual high is worn off, like, I find it harder for me in dealing with her loss. I'm starting to actually miss her. I'm starting to remember memories, like, just talking to her. Like, and when you think about that and you think about the future, you realize you'll never have that again in this life. I find it harder as time goes on rather than easier as time goes on.
Yeah.
So I guess, I mean, like, it's only been 4 months, so time will keep going and we'll see. Hopefully next year will be.
I guess it's like a testament for our church to be able, because, you know, if you ever look at our church and you go outside to someone who says that they're a Christian, you know, like, and you present them with this scenario that we went through, like, how many of them could actually say that they would, after work, come to church and praise God for, like, in honor of her memory, just to praise God, just to praise them? Like, there's no, like, people would say that's not normal. It's not the definition of normal, but it's something that's a testament to us as Christians being able to be presented to that fire and still having the courage and the wisdom not to forsake God, but to, you know, lift his name up in praise. It's one of those things that it's like, even to this day, even whenever I'm just like thinking about it, it's like we really sang songs giving praise to God after, like, someone that meant a lot to us passed away that day. Like, it wasn't like we didn't wait a day or two. We didn't wait a week. We're like, okay, let's do this. It was that day.
It was like hours after.
And then despite the crime, despite what emotions we were going through, we still had the strength to praise and sing.
And I think that also says something about, like, our fellowship and our church, like, as a whole. Like,
yeah,
for us to get together.
To even just come together, like, make that time, because it was just all of a sudden, like, just a text, and, hey, can you guys be here? and everybody showed up, like everyone was here.
And everyone was hurting, like it really took a toll on everyone, but we still came out, came together and worshiped God, so I think that was really awesome.
For sure. I think I can refer back to like what Robert said, because that's how I felt with her passing is, I had that regret where, you know, I saw how everyone was affected by it, and for me, like, the way that it affected me was, man, I didn't get the chance to talk to her like everyone else did. I didn't get to have that relationship with her like everyone else did, you know? And so for me, I guess it brought back my own reflection of things that have gone on in the past years and where I've been gone or I've been out. Mm-hmm. And so her passing really made me be more involved, not just in church, but relationships in the church. It made me expand, you know, relationships in the church and to not take those relationships for granted.
This year was definitely a year of prioritizing, because when life hits you, superficial little thrills and the carnality of Netflix rings hollow in those times. Now when life hits you, you're looking for a strong place to stand because you're realizing I could be moved right now. My faith is really being challenged. And I need something solid, a strong faith to stand on. And now, as life is hitting us upside the head, we're realizing maybe we don't have that. Because oftentimes, we're not wanting to put the time in to be spiritually fit. And so we just want to show up and play. Isn't this fun? Sorry I missed the prayer meeting this morning, but hey, where are we meeting for breakfast? And yeah, hey, I couldn't make church, but is there a fellowship going on somewhere? And so what can happen is we turn the church into just superficial thrills. It's a fun place to be, but we're not willing to put in the time to be spiritually fit. And it's going to hurt you in the end. You know, the YMCA today is only known as a fun place. I go there almost every day of the week. And I'm there oftentimes at lunchtime. Sometimes I'm there after work at 5 and everyone's playing basketball. It's volleyball. They have activities for the kids. So the YMCA is known as a fun place. But originally the YMCA, Young Men's Christian Association, was known as a place where you went to get to know God, to get spiritually fit. And of course, they had these curricular activities on the side to get the young men in, young women, so that there would be an appeal there. But the original idea of the YMCA is let's lure them in with activities and then let's teach them spiritual truths and matter. Today, the spiritual truths and matters are to the wayside. And it's all about the fun. And so if we're not careful, the same thing can happen to the church, that we are luring people in. It's a fun place. We have activities. But the message that we could be sending out to those that we are bringing in is, hey, this is just a fun place. And then when they go through a year like we just went through in 2021, you look around and the only ones standing at the end of the year are the ones that were willing to put the spiritual time in to be fit.
Today, it all begins. I'm seeing my life for the very first time through a different lens. Yesterday, I didn't understand. Driving 35 with a rocket inside, didn't know what I had. While I've been waiting to live, my life's been waiting on me. I'm gonna run. No, I'm gonna fly. I'm gonna know what it means to live and my just be alive. Shout, enough is what I've been told. But it must be a lie, cause the spirit inside says I'm so much more. So let them say what they want. Oh, I dare them to try.
In and out of the church, that I guess we can say has been a low for us also, you know, telling them goodbye. Mm-hmm. So we've had Sarah, we've had Eddie and Sue, you know, Nick Carter. For me personally, Sarah was one of them also. She kind of gave me that was my nudge to be more involved, because I think I depended on her too much, you know, for anything that went on. She's the one who would message me and, hey, we have this gathering, we have this. But now I had to take that initiative to step in and do that for myself. So regards to, you know, everyone that's been listed, as well as Anna, I know she was gone this year as well. Is there anything that you guys remember or take away from whether y'all just had a relationship with them or how it affected y'all, like them leaving?
I think Sue and Eddie, it was really sad to see them go, because they obviously had a big impact on our church in the whole. And I know they had different relationships with everyone in the church. So speaking of lows, my car had broken down earlier this year, just like a couple of months ago. And Sue, actually, I had no car to drive, like nothing. Like my grandparents, I was blessed that they let me use their car, but they needed it back, so I gave them back their car, and then I had like nothing to drive. So I was blessed enough that she let me use her car while she was gone, so I had that to use while I had no car. So and then again with our website, like them bringing that into our church is really awesome. Instagram, like we didn't have those things before, so. And I think that a lot of people use that now, so they really impacted our church as a whole.
Phenomenal. On the way to that trip, I was able to form an even deeper relationship with the guy. I mean, when he first came in and stuff like that, I mean, I didn't really talk to him much, but when we introduced ourselves to each other, I mean, we started working out together. It's cool. I guess it's because we had something in common, military, whatever case is. But to even take it further, it was just incredible to even, like, you know, open myself up to him on the drive to New Braunfels and stuff like that, and then just get his advice on certain things. And, you know, for him to become a brother like that, it was just completely incredible. And the same with Nick Carter. I got the opportunity because of, like I said, what happened in the past. It's like, you know, you need to take the opportunity when you have the opportunity, because it's not forever. It's a window and it will shut. Mm-hmm. So I got the opportunity to be able to take Nick Carter out for lunch right before he left. And that was just an amazing time for us to bond and stuff like that. And just one thing that his mom, her request to us as a church was, you know, take care of her boys. Mm-hmm. And so we got you, brother, and we're here for you. And so we're going to, you know, make the effort to make sure that we maintain the best possible relationship with you, you know?
Yeah, no, so. I appreciate it. And churches are always going to have these bittersweet moments. So we're here as a family, still a pastor, you know, at the funeral, him seeing it, that meant the world to me. I could never replace that. And then not only that, being able to have a place where I could go and call people my family, like just a church where I have put time and effort in forming relationships, and now I'm able to fall back on these relationships mm-hmm. because I'm now suffering through that moment. So, I mean, I cannot forsake the church in mm-hmm. my life for what it has done for me. I like that we have a military base here, because we do get to see these people come in who are involved in church, and yeah, sometimes they're not even saved. I mean, like River, he came in, he yeah. was at the base. We had a great time with him, but yeah. he was not, let's say, a pillar in our mm-hmm. church or even in another fellowship. But then at the same time, on the other end, you have men like Alex, men like Nick Carter, men like Eddie and a couple Sue. Mm-hmm. They come in and they rattle the church. They insert themselves into it like the people who have been here for years. And, you know, I think it's always going to be sad and a low point when we see them go.
Yeah.
But to the opportunity that they were able to form a relationship with us through their time here, that's something that we can fall back on no matter where they are.
Yeah.
Me think, like, what can I do for the church? Like, they did this, and that kind of gets my mind going. Like, what can I do for the church? Like, what can I think of?
Contribute.
Yeah.
And I think the cool thing about people coming in is just like what we're taught. Like, they all feel like family when they come in, whether mm-hmm. it's mm-hmm. Eddie and Sue came from a church in the Fellowship or River. Like, that boy
yeah.
was always with us. We took him out reaching to, was it Midland? Is that where we went yeah. to? Or Odessa? You know what I mean? So I think it's just a testament to us in the church and how we're taught, like, how to treat these people. Like, they're not, you know, somebody who we don't know and, like, we just kind of exclude. They're in the mix with us for however long you're going to be here, you're a part of us. And I don't think we make them feel any different. And we had River, when he went back home, send a card with, like, some money, like, just because he was so grateful. I mean, somebody who wasn't a part of the fellowship, but just so thankful that he was able to have friends. Because a lot of times they come, they have literally nobody that they know here. Like, you know what I mean? And they just form these relationships or these friendships with us that they never expected to have. And definitely God using this church to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's cool.
Before being invited to this church, I went to a different church. And it was kind of like, oh, just go to church, go home. Like, I never felt, like, invited. Mm-hmm. And then when I came here, I was like, oh my goodness, like, you guys do all this stuff, and like there was people like reaching out to me, and now I have relationships with like everybody in the church. So I think that was like a high for me this year. It's great whenever you have fellowship to, or like different people to talk to that have like the same goals as you. You know, you're all driven to the same thing. So
it's like we share a shared vision.
Yeah, the same vision.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
We all, like, want to strive for this church to be able to make an impact in San Angelo, and then it all comes from, like, people like Ed and Sue, who helped us see that vision go even further with the introduction of that website and Instagram. That's something that, you know, it's crazy that we didn't think of it sooner, or maybe it's just something that, I don't know, like, it wasn't meant to happen until they showed up, but I think that's really going to help propel the church to the vision that we have to eventually be able to grow big enough and end up ultimately launching out a couple from the church. So it's definitely one of the things that, like,
Eddie and Sue really did make an impact on the church whenever they got here, like from start to finish. Even whenever Sue wasn't here, Eddie still did everything that he could do. Whenever they were both here, they were just, they were like, they were a power couple, like Priscilla Quill, like,
all the way.
They were something that, like, I want to see. And like, dang, man, that's kind of cool. Like, I still pick up. It's like, even though they're like a young couple, still something like, man, like, they are on a different level. So it's definitely something that, you know, ever since they showed up, it's something that I've been contending for. Like, let me be at that level. Let me say that, like, share the same vision with my wife to be able to do more. So it's definitely something that I learned a lot for them for the time that they were here. So it was awesome for them being here. It was super sad to see them go.
He told me on the trip is that that's what he strove. I don't even know if that's a word. That's something that he strove to do. He wanted to. He was striving to be that person. He wanted to leave an impact on the church, and he very much so did. Him and his wife, and so it's just phenomenal. Like, I guess it's cool to be able to call him like a big brother.
I think each person that has came in honestly has, because Nick Carter, I didn't really have a personal relationship with him either, but just seeing him, I remember, I think it was one of like our classes that we had. To hear him speak was like, whoa, like he, you know, really, he had that vision. Like he's on fire, like he's doing so good. So it was pretty cool to like see him, like just how he, you know, just talk about it. That was awesome. Yeah, for sure.
Just to know you haven't lied to at some point or place. Well, I can relate. And you're wondering if it's worth it. Heartbroken, feeling worthless. So the hurt is too great. Like a punch in the face. But don't forget, we got something else in common.
this past Wednesday, we had canceled our Wednesday night service just to have a Christmas party, and it was a great time. We had fun, but imagine that people start coming up to me and say, hey, wasn't that great? I mean, why don't we start canceling services every Wednesday night and having like just a fellowship? And I could see that that would seem like really fun, you know, let's just, let's just cancel all our services and let's just fellowship all the time and have fun. And we can lose sight that it's not about that, that our primary focus as Christians is first to live life and live life to the fullest, but also to live life for God, because there's lots of people out there that are living life to the fullest, but they're not living their life for God. So our primary focus is not fun, it's living for God. To me, I'm reflecting on the year, and one of the highlights for me was the Mercy Me concert. I'm so glad that we pushed through and went to that. And I remember one particular song that really touched me at the concert. They had it was a new album, a lot of new songs that I kind of like the old ones, but in reflection, those are some really good songs. And one of them that we sang at that concert was We're Almost Home. And I remember Stacy was at that concert with us, and so it was a very good song, and many of us were singing that song either out loud or in our minds, and I know that Stacy would have been singing that song also on the other side of the Coliseum. Let me just read you some of the words of that song that I have here. It says, are you disappointed? Are you desperate for help? You know what it's like to be tired, only a shell of yourself. Well, you start to believe you don't have what it takes, because it's all you can do just to move, much less finish the race. But don't forget what lies ahead. We're almost home, brother. It won't be long. Soon all your burdens will be done. With all your strength, sister, run wild, run free. Hold up your head. Keep pressing on. We're almost home. And Stacy, as I said, would have been at that concert singing that song with us. And who would have known that night that as we're all touched and moved by such a beautiful song, of course, we all know what the song is about. It's about going home, going to heaven to be with Jesus. But who would have known singing it that night that Stacy was literally singing that song for herself and that soon would come to pass in her life. And so what a special night that was for her. It was a special night for us that we shared with her. But isn't that where we're all striving to be? We have to remember that at the end of the day, no matter what the church is doing, no matter what we're involved in, no matter how much fun we're having, the ultimate goal of every Christian in this church and every Christian worldwide really is really we're all striving just to make it home. That's the end game. That is the best prize that we could ever get. What we are striving for is not fun and greatness or making our name for ourselves here on earth. What we're really all striving for individually and then trying to encourage each other as a whole is to make heaven our home. That's really the end goal. And Stacy made it there. She finished the race. She got there before us. And you know, what a special night that was. And that's our goal. Our goal is to get there also. That is the end game goal. Don't ever get confused about what you're striving for, what life's about. At the end of the day, come hell or high water, our goal is to make heaven our home.
Now, I guess moving on to touch back with this year. So we've had about 160 sermons per year, not counting revivals and conferences and like harvesters and stuff like that. So is there anything in particular, a sermon in particular, a revival maybe that stuck out to you guys that we had this year
What if we said all of them?
Like, there's not just one, because they all played their place. Like,
is there one that you could maybe like reference back to?
The one recently that Pastor preached on Wednesday, I was like, man, it touched me deeply, because there's times that I'd be saying stuff like that, like, if I wasn't a Christian boy,
yeah.
You know what I mean? And stuff like that, because at work, I'm telling you, they can, and Aaron knows, they can get under your skin. We all know. I mean, they can really get under your skin, and then it's like you have these outside voices and or influencers, and they're like, yeah, they think they're something because they're in the military. They want to hide behind the uniform and stuff like that. But if they weren't, it'd be a different story and stuff like that. So it's just like, man, just be a Christian, you know? Would Jesus say that? And stuff like that. So that sermon that he preached, and then not only that, and how I treat y'all and how I treat the people around me and stuff like that. You just gotta, you are an ambassador for Jesus Christ. And so, I mean, every sermon speaks to me, but that one recently, boy, it hit different.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I think the one I really liked was, not against Pastor, but it was one that Eddie preached about checking your foundations, like looking introspectively at yourself. So that, like, that really, I really like that one, because, like, ever since he started, like, ever since he preached that, that's something I've definitely been continuing for. Like, help me not to look outwardly at other people. Help me to be able to look at myself, find out what I'm lacking in, find out what I'm struggling with, and set that before God, and, like, to try to handle that, to try to get help for that. That's one of, like, that's one of the ones that really have stuck with me since he's preached about it.
I really liked the one that you recently preached, Do You Have a Vision? It was crazy to see that he had that old notebook with all of his visions written down.
Cool.
And that just shows you that, like, if you contend for that stuff and you are strong in your prayer, that God will, you know, provide and come through and, you know, answer those prayers. So, yeah, that one really was just like, whoa.
Is there any sermons that stand out for you?
Yeah, I mean, maybe not sermon specifically, but the revival with Pastor Robbins, you know, obviously when he gave you the word and stuff, you know, I'll never forget that, because I don't get words often like that. And I remember one thing he said was, you know, you're single, you know, you're unchained, like, just do everything that you can. And I feel like, you know, I've done that, like, anytime there's a gathering or anything like that, like, I try to go and make it a point. To where back then, you know, maybe I didn't make it as much of a point. I was like, man, I just kind of want to chip on myself or do my own thing. And another one, maybe not a sermon specifically, but like when Nick, you know, talked at his mom's funeral, like to me,
for
I was like, bro, like the way he handled it, the words that he was saying, like, you know, for someone who, you know, the first guy to give you a ride to church, you know, to see who you were then, to who, like, I was looking at and watching talk at that time, I was like, where it's like day and night, like a completely different person. And, you know, and it's just cool to see, because, you know, we joke all the time and stuff like that. And to see you, like, in that serious mode and, like, know, like, understand, like, man, this man gets it. Like, he understands it. Like, I don't know if I'd be able to do it the way he did it. Like, to me, that was just like a proud brother moment. Like, that's my brother up there, like, talking like that. Like, talking to these people, some of them he's never met, doesn't know. And he's just, you know, up there, in the midst of all this, talking about how he loves God and how, you know, God did this and God did that. And to me, like, I'll just never forget that, because it's just crazy to see again the kid that I picked up that one day, like, he's doing this now. And so that, like, again, not a sermon specifically, but something I'll definitely never forget. Like, I don't think, you know, you get the credit you deserve sometimes for how young you are and how mature you are. Again, I know we joke all the time, you know, you can be immature and we can all be immature, but like you get it. And for me, that was an encouragement for sure. So
you know, I had three or four people come up to me after and say, I want to go to your church. So it's, you know, we represent, it's like the crucible of fire, that sermon, you know, we're practicing for the day that we are put through the crucible of our own fire, of our own trauma. And when we're able to reference back to all the training that we've endured to actually use that and get through our season, it's not just a testimony to my life, but to our church, the other people in the church. So, yeah, I mean, our church did amazing at that funeral service. Not just me, but Pastor, my brothers who were able to be the pallbearers and carry the casket, and Melina singing, you know, our church was the star of that show, if we want to put it like that. So it was, you know, finally able. So I was happy to see our church get exposure like that and say, you know, it shoots down all this talk outside our church. We're this, we're that, we're the, you know, people don't know. And until you, your church gets put through something like that, you won't know. And for not only the people from the outside looking in, for me looking out to our church to see them there, they're working, they're getting stuff done, having the reception after. I mean, it was good to see our church come together like that. And yeah, that was the Holy Spirit. I mean, through that whole thing when I was talking, I mean, for me to remember word for word what I said, I'll have to go watch it again. I mean, it was just, you know, one of those supernatural things at the time. But after that, you know, to represent my church like that and everything that we've learned and been taught and fed ourselves to, for people to come up to me and tell me, hey, I want to go to your church like that. That's incredible. And I need to remember those, because those are the people that I'm going to invite out to revival when we come. So it's a reference point for me to look back and say, you need to remember to do that, because they said that. So it just reminded me now that's something I need to work on too.
And I think it goes back to us, like, as a church, like a family, like how you said, everybody's just, you know, it's one thing like, hey, like, I'll be at the funeral, my condolences, but like you said, everybody's doing something, trying to, hey, like, can we help? And not like just like, hey, like, if you need anything, let me know. Like, it's genuine, like, if you need anything, like,
it is.
You know, let me know. And I know, you know, it helped you, and I'm sure it helped Gary, you know, to just have, like, actual family. And I feel like that word is just tossed around so often nowadays, like, oh, like, that's my family. But, like, when we say it here, like, we're a legit family. Like, yeah, we may fight sometimes, we may get into arguments, but at the end of the day, like, you know, these are my brothers, these are my sisters. Yeah, this is family. Like, we're never going to, there's not ever going to be a time where somebody needs something, or we're just going to be like, all right, like, deal with it on your own. Like, we're just, like, a genuine family. So, I think it's just cool, like, when we go through things, you know, it's not cool to go through things like that, but when you go through those things that you have, like, an actual family that cares, has the same vision for you, and, again, just genuinely loves you and wants to make sure that you're okay.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Yeah.
I think that's something also, like, going, one of my favorite sermons and going into that, like, the lows that we kind of faced and stuff as a church. And I think that we did face this as a church, because I've spoken to other people, even people that are not here today. But they even told me that they, like, went through the same thing. For me, like, this year, I hit a spot where I was kind of questioning if I wanted to stay in the church. Mm-hmm. And I know that there was other people that faced that this year. Mm-hmm. Like, it just seemed like this year was, it was so good for us, like, just all in general. But then we also had those, I guess, where the enemy tried to, like, sneak in and try to, you know. And so that was one thing that I was facing, like, for sure. And it happened to be the week of your mom's passing. Like, before your mom's passing, I was really feeling that way, like, should I leave the church? Like, I felt like I didn't belong, or I didn't need to be here. And I think it was just all my emotions coming in with Sarah leaving and just everything in general. I just felt like I didn't fit in anymore. And Harvesters, actually, like, just Odessa, just in general, like, every single sermon, like, hit. And I remember specifically in my notes, I wrote down the last sermon that was preached in Harvesters. I wrote that in my notes, like, this is the day that I got confirmation that I belong in this church. Yeah. Like, this is my family.
That's cool.
Because, like, the sermon was, you know, based on, you know, the church itself and your pastor and what they do for you, and just basically all the work that they, you know, put in. And it just made me, like, I knew that there was a reason specifically for me to be there in Odessa. And that was it. Like, that's what I was looking for, was that whole experience.
And weren't you not going to stay the last
sermon? Yeah, I was not going to. Yeah, I was not going to stay that last sermon, but I ended up staying because I was like, I have to stay. Like, there's just something that's telling me I have to stay. Mm-hmm. There's a reason. And so I ended up staying, though I really wasn't going to, because I had already, like, packed. I stayed without clothes. Like, I even went to Walmart that night to go and buy clothes because I, like, all my stuff had already gotten packed up and we weren't even going to stay the night. But yeah, and so that was like a reference for me, like, this is why I stayed. Mm-hmm. This is why. And I think honestly, even then, that's kind of where our, like, relationship kind of grew more, because we had talked before, but not really like that, you know, and that gave me not just time to speak to you, but with Crystal, like, we really, it was, it's one of those things where, you know, I mean, I had to expand more in the church because I felt like with Sarah being here, it almost became a little cliquish. Like, we get really comfortable with the people that we're with, and so it becomes really cliquish, and you don't mean to, it's just who you're comfortable with, but that's how I was with Sarah. And so with her leaving, it really pushed me, like, not just with you. I think that weekend I was able to speak with Kathy and Jeff, and that's something I wanted to do for the longest time, but I didn't have the courage doing, but that weekend I did. And so, yeah, for sure, my relationships expanded that weekend, and that was something that I can reference back. That was really great.
On top of that, I feel like we've had a lot of fruit this year.
Yeah.
I can say that we've not only had a ton of visitors, we've had some visitors stay and get saved, and people return. So I think that's definitely a high point of our church this year, just for to sure. have new pillars filling in and new disciple or disciplelets being made, and hopefully new seeds sown for future fruit to be grown here. So I think that's another high point, and among many others I could sit here and think about.
Yeah, I think for the church in general, I think touching back like on Eddie's sermon that he preached before leaving, was you get to see that we're all united, like, in vision as well. Because one of the things that he mentioned, I guess it really didn't, I didn't really think about it until he mentioned it, was how we all have had housewarming parties, like, this year. So it's cool to see that, you know, that we all were blessed, you know, that we all have, you know, the same vision, and it's like happening like right after another, like everyone, like, you got a job promotion, and then again, you know, you got your house. That was a really high for me that I got my house. Like, and that was one of the things I really, again, going back to, like, I wasn't even going to stay. Like, I was planning on leaving to Dallas or to San Antonio.
Yeah.
And I had already gotten an apartment in Dallas. Like, I had already paid for it and everything. Like, not a lot of people know that, but I did. And last minute, I said, you know what? Just keep the money. I'm not moving. Like, I don't. Just keep it. I don't need my deposit back. I ended up staying, and within that same week, I got my house.
Oh,
like,
wow.
Right after I turned that down. So, yeah, that was a high for me, for sure. Getting my house, being able to have that place, you know, to have people over, to host fellowships, to, you know, just to, you know, do whatever, and just for XL to have his own space. So, yeah, for sure. And my job, I'm thankful for that. Like, our contract was supposed to end this month, and I didn't know what I was gonna do, but we got extended so till March. I mean, it's still something, and there's also new contracts coming up, so that's a high for me for sure.
Oh, and I got saved this year, so that's really good.
Is there any high points y'all?
Oh, yeah. I think this year for Brittany and I, it was a good year for us, like, as far as fellowships go. I felt like we were doing a fellowship, like...
Oh, yeah. Y'all went crazy on fellowships this year. That was cool.
It was
really cool.
Yeah. It was just one of those things that I know that she's always been on board for, and it took me a while to actually, like, pray for that spirit of hospitality to be in me. And then once I got a hold of that, I haven't let go of it. Like, I want to keep doing that. And then, like, I feel like we've just been having fellowships. Like, after Snowmageddon happened, I feel like we just, like, there wasn't really a time when we went more than, like, 2 or 3 weeks without someone at our house. The Friendsgiving thing, I mean, that's just going to be, like, one of many. Like,
yeah,
it was definitely one of the things that I want to, that we want to be able to push forward and do more, even things like for Christmas, we just want to be able to do more stuff with the church and with, like, the family that we have in this church. So the biggest thing is, like, the fellowships that we were able to have, I was really, really happy about that.
I got a new job opportunity and I took it. And also touching back on, like, revivals, Robinson gave me a word on, like, fear, and that I need to, like, rebuke the fear in my life. And whenever that job opportunity came to me, I was at a job my previous job, I was there for 4 years. So, like, you can only imagine, like, how uncomfortable it could be to leave a job for 4 years.
And so I kind of just looked back on that time and what he had, the word that he had spoken to me. And I was like, I'm just gonna do it and go for it. So that's a high point this year. And then also speaking on like tithes, like at my other church that I used to go to, they really didn't talk about tithing and offering like we do here. So I started tithing, and then I started putting an offering every time, you know, we're here at church. And so I kind of look at it as God blessing with that new job. I was able to get a new car this year. That happened within like the same month, my job and then me getting my new car. And then also, I was kind of unhappy with like my living situation, just like, you know, not having your own space. And with that, I got a new, I now live on my own and was blessed to have a new place.
Oh, like, your house looks fire.
Thanks.
Yeah. I didn't tell you, but it was good.
Thanks.
It was good.
Yeah.
We were supposed to say me.
Blessing. Huh?
Me.
Oh, and him.
Yeah, I mean, for me, for sure, you know, the new job that I got is definitely high. I mean, I remember whenever I got fired from Time Clock 2 years ago and they rehired me, I was doing the paperwork and stuff whenever I was being hired here, and like I'm making double what I was making when they hired me. So to me, it's like, that's crazy. And you know, just thinking about like how we got there or how I got there, you know, at the beginning of the year, I just made a decision that I'm gonna tithe no matter what, like no matter what happens, I'm going to tithe. And even at the beginning of the year, like, I wasn't even attending church as frequently as I should have been. I remember Pastor sent me a text message one time, like, hey, like, I got your tithe and I appreciate it, but it'd be nice to see you around a little bit more. I was like, yeah, you know, probably a good thing. And so another high for me is just, like, my attendance and the events and stuff that I've been coming to. Like, for past years, and sad to say, like, it's been, like, is he going to come, is he not? Like, it's just, you know, in and out. And this year, I feel like it's just, it's no longer a question. Like, I'm just going to be at church and, you know, I'm going to be at whatever they invite me to go to. So that and my tithe, like, it's just been a super high for me. And I mean, I've seen the difference, you know, in the relationships that I have with you guys, the friendships, you know, again, being blessed with this amazing job opportunity where I work way less than I used to at Time Clock, and I get paid way more than, you know, I did over there. And, you know, that's God. There's no, like, I mean, yes, I understand, like, I'm smart and I get some things, but there's no way that I would have found this job in Dallas that's going to just let me work from home and, you know, kind of just go at my own pace and chill out and get paid more than I've ever been paid for, paycheck to paycheck like that. So I think that's definitely high, and you know, it's all credit to God and just tithing. Just, it's crazy when you do just the things that you're supposed to do, what happens, right? Like, not doing anything crazy. I'm not out there, you know, doing mission trips in Africa or anything. Like, I'm literally just tithing, going to church and praying and reading, and you know, he's just opening opportunities. And I know it's just the beginning of it. So this year in general is, you know, we've had low points, but for me, as far as my salvation, has been definitely a high this year so far. So
you know, when we go around the circle listening to everyone talk, it's all a financial blessing. So I think that's, you know, for me, it's been the same thing, blessings financially. And, you know, paying tithe, it works wonders in your life. And, you know, it's hard. I've had to put hundreds of dollars just off for one tithe this past year, multiple times, different amounts. But, you know, whenever you finally start making a decent amount of money and you go to pay your tithe, you're looking at that like, I'm losing this money now. Like, that's a lot of money I'm giving in. But whenever, you know, when you shake that and you break that and you give just because that's your tithe, you know, I was giving, you know, that percentage when I had little, I'm going to give it now when I have a decent amount of money. So when you're able to break that, you can see God work in your life. And, you know, hearing one story after another, then you got your house this year. I think back in March, right? March or April?
No.
So a little later? June. It was a little later? Yeah, so back in June. So, you know, being able to see these families prosper just from being in the church and doing what they're supposed to do, I think the finances of the church and the individuals who tithe in the church is one of our highest points this year.
And it concludes everything. Since we do have Bible study tonight, I think we touched on everything, you know, the highs and the lows and the good memories and some not so good, but that pretty much sums up our year.
It's been a difficult year. And what I've noticed about our church is that We have risen to the occasion time and time again. Instead of backing down, we have risen to the occasion. And I'm so proud of our church and how our church has performed this year. You know, if you weren't part of the reception after Stacy's funeral, you missed out. We had a reception here at the church following the funeral, and this place was packed out from the sanctuary front doors all the way to the back doors of the fellowship hall. This church was packed out, and it was so good to see the people in our church. We weren't all huddled in a corner just trying to fellowship with ourselves, avoiding, you know, these people that are grieving, they're hurting, they're crying. No, what I saw with our church was that we actually all spread out and we were out there ministering to these hurting people that were grieving tremendously. And as I looked around, I would see, you know, pockets of the members of our congregation throughout the sanctuary, throughout the fellowship hall, engaging perfect strangers in conversation and just trying to lighten the mood a little. And there was laughter going on in the sanctuary. We had laughter going on back here in the fellowship hall. And our church really rose up to the occasion saying, you know, we have an opportunity to try to minister to these hurting people. They are grieving, and we can either just sit in a corner huddled to ourselves and, well, there's the church group and there's Stacy's family. No, we completely mingled with them and lightened the mood and introduced ourselves to them. And many people were really impressed, and I got a lot of compliments on that reception. I got a lot of compliments on the people in our church and their friendliness and their love. And it was like that throughout the whole year. Whenever we were pushed against the wall, I saw that instead of our church backing down, we rose to the occasion and we were stronger through it. And, you know, I hate to use the old cliche, but it is true. And so what doesn't kill us makes us stronger. And I believe that after everything that we went through in 2021, as difficult as it was, that at the end of the day, I believe, and I'm sure you would agree, that our church came out stronger and better because of it. And we're looking forward to a great year in 2022. And no doubt, we are going to start off the year the exact same way we started off in 2021. We're going to start it off with prayer and fasting, because we really do believe that when we seek God at the beginning of the year and ask Him just to go before us, even as He went before Israel in a pillar cloud by day and a pillar fire by night and prepared the way for them, we do believe that whatever God has in store for us, whatever the enemy might have in store for us, it doesn't matter. We will just start the year off the same way in 2022, and that is by seeking God and praying and contending and committing. God, we commit this year in your hands. God is going to go before us the same way, and I'm believing for a great year, and I thank you for everyone for helping us and staying in your place, standing your ground in
2022. Disappointed? Are you desperate for help? You know what it's like to be tired and only a shell of yourself. But you start to believe you don't have what it takes. Cause it's all you can do just to move, much less finish the race. But don't forget what lies ahead. Of Jesus in us, it's not if but when. So take joy in the journey, even when it feels long. Oh, find strength in each step, knowing heaven is cheering you.
We make it to the finish line. A lot of times we are not going to determine how we make it to the finish line. But one thing is for sure, we are all striving to make it home.